This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
People are still expressing their anger in the streets of Mauritania in response to the military coup there. While protesters have increased their activities, the new rulers have escalated their oppression and pursuit of the demonstrators and organizers. We leave you with a report by Mahmoudi Mohammed from Nouakchott.
Police forces were deployed in the early hours of this morning in the main square near this clinic. They closed commercial stores and major streets. This is the area where the demonstration of the National Front for the Defense of Democracy was supposed to begin. However, another reality was imposed by the new military rulers. They oppress those who oppose the toppling of the ousted president Sidi Ould al-Sheikh Abdullah. This man was carrying the poster of the ousted president. The police followed him, took the poster from him, and beat him harshly.
The police are trying to deter us from organizing a legal demonstration in support of returning the legitimately elected regime.
This was not the end of it. He was dropped to the ground and beaten up badly. The police also took out this man from his home and opened this dialogue with him. Other people decided to protest out of their windows, while others decided to play hide-and-seek with the police in the alleyways away from the major streets.
Sidi Ould al-Sheikh Abdullah must return to ensure national unity.
The daughter of the head of the National Assembly Party, which opposes the coup, was not spared because she was a woman. At the end, the residents of the complex were able to get out of their homes and hold a demonstration in large groups. They burned tires despite receiving a wave of tear gas bombs.
There are calls in Turkey to reconsider the country's policy towards the PKK. The army has been strongly criticized for its failure to deter attacks that it should have known about beforehand.
Not only are the Turkish civilians criticizing the army, but also among political circles, there has been criticism.
بعد سقوط 17 جنديا تركيا قتيلا في هجوم حزب العمال الكردستاني
Last week, 11 Turkish soldiers were killed in an attack by the PKK in the village of Aktutun. This led the Turkish army to move the police station to a safer area, which is an important sign that the army is indirectly acknowledging negligence in protecting the Turkish soldiers there. Many military experts said that such police stations along the Turkish-Iraqi border are easy prey to the PKK fighters who hide behind these mountains. However, the army's negligence does not stop there.
لكن التقصير لا يقف عند هذا الحد.
According to the Turkish Taraf newspaper, Air Force Commander General Aydogan Babagoglu was playing golf the day after the attack. The newspaper also said that the army knew in advance about the attack and followed it with satellite images. Despite all this, the army failed to deter the attack. The Turkish Chief of Staff, İker Başbuğ, promised to investigate the incident and vowed to punish those who were responsible for the negligence. However, these facts compelled the Turks to reconsider previous accusations against the governments of Iraq and the Kurdish region of not doing enough to stop these attacks. This incident made the Turks seriously look within for chronic political and military mistakes. These mistakes may have prolonged the war with the PKK for more than 25 years. There are even calls from within the military institution demanding that the Turkish policy towards the PKK be reconsidered. Retired General Osman Bamugulu, who spent 15 years fighting the PKK, has been demanding this the most. To achieve the desired objective, Osman Bamugulu strongly demanded political change by going to the Justice and Equality Party, which he formed.
The government completely holds the army responsible. The army's bureaucracy constrains soldiers from pursuing the armed PKK in the mountains. This is a big mistake. There is no cooperation between our intelligence agencies.
Bamugulu promised the voters to eliminate the PKK if he takes office. Regardless of the details, it is obvious that Turkey has begun to hold itself accountable and has begun to look seriously at its own mistakes. Turkey also began to reject the saying that Turkey has to fight the PKK indefinitely. Yusuf al-Sharif, Al Jazeera, along the Iraqi-Turkish borders.
مشاهدينا في لبنان حيث أن الأمطار الغزيرة التي هطلت اليوم في لبنان ساهمت إلى حد كبير.
Heavy rainfall in Lebanon today was a great help in putting out the fire that has been burning for three days. The fire swallowed hundreds of acres of woods, pine, oak and olive trees in the two areas of the Kharoub province and the Shouf in Mount Lebanon.
لولا الرحمة الإلهية وسقوط الأمطار بغزارة صباح اليوم لكانت الحرائق التي اندلعت بالأمس في عدد من المناطق اللبنانية.
If it wasn't for God's mercy and the heavy rain this morning, the fires that began yesterday in a number of Lebanese areas in Mount Lebanon, specifically in the Kharoub province, would still be in flames. It would have swallowed all that remained of the woodland, the olive, pine and oak trees, which give this area its unique beauty. Up until dawn today, efforts to stop the fire and protect people's property had not been successful. The fire reached their land, livelihood and homes, which led many of them to flee in fear of suffocation.
The Lebanese people and the Arab nation as a whole will be affected by what happened yesterday. The green areas have shrunk and the long-term repercussions are larger than you can imagine. Today, we are depriving the air of large amounts of oxygen and humidity and killing the biological diversity in the burned areas. As you know, it will take more than 100 years for the biological diversity to regenerate itself. I want to tell the presidents, kings, and officials of the Arab countries that we have to establish a scientific committee to maintain the green wealth. Don't think that if a forest in Lebanon burns up, it only affects that area. No, everyone suffers the consequences, the whole country and its neighbors.
النيران التي اندلعت في مشهد مكلل بالعجز والإهمال الرسميين كانت قد تنقلت بسرعة.
The fires spread in a scene of helplessness and negligence. It spread quickly from one area to the next in the Kharoub district, wiping out hundreds of acres of greenery. The fire was accompanied by hot, strong winds. The National Guard had to draw on the water tanks of water cellars in the area to put out the fire in areas that the army helicopters could not move through because of the strong winds. But the obstacles facing the firefighters were not limited to the strong winds. Other obstacles included water shortages, rough terrain, and cluster bombs. This prevented the National Guard from containing the fire and led to the injury of three Lebanese soldiers and a firefighter. Tamer Al-Bustani, mayor of Dibiya, said that what happened was an environmental catastrophe. He called for declaring Al-Dibiya a disaster area. As for the reason behind the fire, it is likely connected to the olive picking season, during which farmers intentionally burned the grass.
بموسم قطاف الزيتون حيث يعمد المزارعون إلى حرق الأعشاب.
According to the latest statistics, the green areas in Lebanon no longer exceed 13%. Today, after this fire, many people expect they no longer exceed 9%. For Al-Madar, this is Alamullah, Dubai TV, Lebanon.
تواجه العائلات العراقية المقيمة في مصر صعوبات.
Iraqi families living in Egypt face a great deal of difficulties because many of them can't afford high school tuition, which forces them to leave school. An Al-Sharqiya reporter provides us with more details on this issue, which became a source of concern for thousands of Iraqi families living there.
One can tell the future of a country by knowing the level of education in it, especially among the younger generations. Today, Iraqi students living abroad face many challenges pertaining to their schools and future.
Some of the Iraqi community in Egypt does not even have their kids registered in elementary schools. Only a small percentage of Iraqis go to universities because school tuition is extremely high and people can't afford them. The Iraqi community in Egypt suffers a great deal from this. According to what I know about the Iraqi community here, most people, including me, do not send our sons and daughters to school. My son Mustafa is in his second year studying engineering, but he could not continue his education here and he was forced to return to Baghdad.
However, returning home might not be the solution. Many of those who return to Iraq could not finish their school there, either because they left many years ago or because they have to meet different criteria to continue their education in Iraq.
I tried to go back home. I went to the Iraqi embassy to see if the universities in Iraq can accept what I have learned in Egypt, but I was told that my credits will not be accepted. Therefore, I was forced to complete my education here, although the university that I go to has a very high tuition.
The cost of attending school has been increasing dramatically. It costs thousands of dollars. Iraqi students are wondering why Iraqi officials are not helping them seek an education. Regardless of how long Iraqis live abroad, one day they will come back and serve their country.
Every year the cost of education goes up and we can't afford the costs. We came from Iraq and we live in exile. Not everyone can afford the high tuition.
No matter how long we live abroad, ultimately we will come back to our country. We want to help our country. They should take care of us and help us in this situation. Truly, tuition is very expensive.
Iraqi men and women were once living together in their country. Now they are dispersed in exile. Today they have one common concern because they face an uncertain future. Will anyone respond to their calls for help? This is what they told us, and we are conveying it to those who might be concerned. Ali Zubaydi, Al-Sharqiya, Cairo.
Ali Zubaydi, Qanat Al-Sharqiya, Al-Qahira.
In a speech he gave during a meeting in Iran with the head of the Iranian Consultative Council, Ali Larijani, the Speaker of the Iraqi Council of Representatives, Mahmoud al-Mashadani, said that the wounds inflicted on Iraq will not be healed with the presence of foreign forces in the country. Meanwhile, Larijani said that Iraq's long-term security agreement with the U.S. will have a negative impact on Iraq's sovereignty and the sovereignty of the entire region. In another development, al-Mashadani described his country's relationship with Iran as very important. Al-Mashadani further said that the strengthening relationship between Iran and Iraq will definitely help improve stability and prosperity in the region. Meanwhile, Larijani said they need to employ the appropriate mechanisms that will help develop the various sectors of cooperation between the two countries, and he offered Iran's help in this field. Iraq's Member of Parliament and representative for the United Iraqi Alliance, Abbas Albiati, called on the U.S. to provide support for Iraq through their long-term security agreement, which is pending between the two sides. Albiati said that Iraq needs the U.S.'s help to get Baghdad out of Article 7 of the U.N. Charter. He further said removing Iraq from the U.N. mandate must be at the top of the U.S.'s administration's agenda. Moreover, Albiati said that the U.S. must help Iraq counter any foreign attacks on its territories. He also called for the protection of Iraq's democratic process from any act of insurgency or coup d'etat that may strike at any time.
The latest statements issued by Iraqi officials indicate that negotiations over the security agreement with Baghdad and Washington have entered into a final stage. During a joint press conference with U.S. Deputy Secretary of State John Negroponte, Iraq's foreign minister, Hushair Zebari, said that signing the security agreement between Iraq and the U.S. requires both sides to take courageous political decisions. Meanwhile, Negroponte confirmed that they have reached an agreement on a number of disputed issues, issues. According to Iraqi sources, Washington has refused to enter into any amendments on the draft security agreement. Meanwhile, Iraq's Member of Parliament and the representative of the United Iraqi Alliance, Jinan al-Abiadi, confirmed that Iraqis are not under any obligation to sign any agreement that doesn't help remove Iraq from Article 7 of the United Nations Charter and which doesn't help reorganize the deployment of foreign forces in Iraq. Al-Abiadi added that no constituent can pressure the Iraqi government into lowering its ceiling of demands or forcing it into signing an unbalanced strategic agreement with Washington. Meanwhile, U.S. Deputy Secretary of State John Negroponte said that the bilateral talks between Baghdad and Washington over the strategic agreement have reached an advanced stage. However, Negroponte stopped short of listing the obstacles that have been delaying its endorsement. Negroponte confirmed that they have reached a common denominator on a number of the disputed issues. He added that the negotiations have reached an advanced stage but couldn't go into details. The U.S. diplomat said the government of Baghdad stressed the importance of getting it out of Article 7 of the United Nations Charter. Furthermore, the U.S. and Iraq must find a legal text that helps outline the redeployment of foreign forces in Iraq. Negroponte further said that this was his fifth trip to Iraq since beginning his tenure as ambassador and that a lot of security and economic progress had been made. He added that Iraq has achieved over the course of time a lot of security and political progress, and the recent passage of the provincial election law by Parliament is noteworthy. In another development, the U.S. military announced the withdrawal of the Armenian battalion, which was part of the U.S.-led coalition forces deployed in Iraq. The U.S. Army added that the Armenian Brigade, which consisted of 46 military personnel, has ended its duty with Iraq with a celebration that was held at Victory Base in Baghdad. The Armenian force was deployed in Iraq on January 2, 2005, and since then it provided ground support for Polish forces, which ended their duty in Iraq last Saturday. The Polish forces, which included 900 military personnel, will withdraw from Iraq by the end of the current month. During 2003, the number of coalition troops stood at 175,000, which included 150,000 U.S. military personnel, with the remaining troops coming from 40 other countries. Today, there are nearly 144,000 U.S. troops in Iraq and less than 7,000 troops from other countries.
أهلا بكم من جديد. يحتفل العالم بيوم الغذاء العالمي، لكن الاحتفال.
Welcome back. The world celebrates One World Food Day, but the celebration will be nothing more than an occasion to face new numbers that draw a grim picture about famine in developing countries. Today, there are about 1 billion starving in the world due to the world food crisis and rising prices.
The Oxfam Organization for Humanitarian Work surveyed 120 individuals who are nearing the brink of human catastrophe. In turn, about 1 billion people are threatened by the ghost of famine. Oxfam predicts that the situation will be grimmer in the coming days. Earlier this year, the World Food Program said that its world food bill rose by 50% in the last 5 years. The program also predicted that grain imports in developing countries will increase $52 billion this year. This prediction came after wheat reached record highs last September due to a drought hitting Australia, which shrunk the world's reserve to its lowest level in 26 years. "20% of people in developing countries struggle to provide a small amount of food that does not cover the necessary calories to live. According to some global estimates, if all those people were gathered together, they would form a continent of hungry people. The size of this continent would exceed all of North America and Western Europe combined. Those people are concentrated in the African Horn, which is the most affected. 17 million people across Ethiopia, Somalia, Kenya, and Djibouti. Aid organizations say that $400 million at least are needed to offer emergency aid to those affected by drought in these areas." The reports issued on the World Food Day criticize the governmental negligence of developed and industrial countries in their financial support to end hunger and poverty. The amount of aid spent to fight fatal famine is less than what they spend on armament and less than what Europe spends on alcoholic drinks, for example. Nawal Ayad, Al Arabiya.
Thank you.
The Tel Aviv Stock Exchange swung widely today, closing with moderate losses. Today's trading comes in the wake of big drops on Wall Street and other world markets. Losses were most pronounced in Asia, as IBA correspondent Elisha Rabin reports.
It was a roller coaster day on the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange that ended with investor fears being soothed by a mild rather than major decline. Both the Tel Aviv 25 and 100 were down 3%. Real estate stocks lost almost 6%. Some investors have been concerned about Tel Aviv's ability to weather the international financial storm, with markets here losing roughly 20% since July. But the major crashes abroad of the past few weeks have largely been avoided in Israel.
Israel is already in the market with declining, still relatively to outside of Israel, the market is still okay.
Helping the economic forecast, the Bank of Israel believes inflation for the year will likely close in the 1% zone. That comes even as inflation has already reached 5% this year. Economists expect inflation to drop by the year's end, erasing increases from earlier this year. That would likely come from falling commodity prices worldwide. Oil, in particular, has become cheaper globally, trading just over $74 a barrel in New York. Meanwhile, efforts to right the teetering world economy continue. The Swiss government made a surprise move to pump nearly 60 billion Swiss francs onto the balance sheets of UBS and Credit Suisse. Swiss officials as recently as yesterday were betting that the country's banking system would be able to rely on cash reserves and hundreds of years of tradition to weather the current economic crisis. That bit of uncertainty was compounded by a major loss in Tokyo and mild losses elsewhere. Japan's Nikkei index lost 11.5%. Economists there predicted the market trouble would continue well into 2009. In Europe, fears of an overall global recession sent shares across the continent tumbling. The FTSE and the CAC 40 lost 3%, while the DAX lost 2%. In London, one problem troubling banks is the growing possibility that borrowers will not be able to repay their debts. That concern made it increasingly more difficult for banks to buy insurance policies that back up loans in the event that they are not repaid.
One of the problems is that the markets don't know where these losses are going to fall, and they've been terrified about where they'll show up, and that's made them very frightened to lend to each other, so there's that issue. The other issue is you have to find the money.
For IBA News, I'm Elisha Rabin.
President Shimon Peres today observed the annual tradition of opening the presidential sukkah to thousands of guests. For well over 3 hours, the 85-year-old president greeted and chatted with visitors, including Israelis from across the country, as well as guests from abroad. For the first time, the president also opened the grounds of his residence to exhibits displaying Israeli achievements in technology, agriculture, and environment. Among those who managed to exchange a few words with Peres was IBA's Leah Zinder.
In view of the economic crisis, it seems the flimsy sukkah has never been more symbolic. As somebody who once saved the Israeli economy, give us some words of hope and comfort on this Chag.
Well, I think that the present economy is no longer based on the past, but very much on the future. The creative capacities of a nation will decide the future of our economy. And Israel is doing until now quite well. I think the present crisis will pass away. It takes a little bit of time, but it doesn't have a long duration.
In honor of the Sukkot holiday, more than 20,000 Jewish worshippers made their way to the Western Wall in Jerusalem today to attend the priestly blessing held at the site of the last remnant of the Second Temple. The blessing is given 3 times each year on Passover, Shavuot, and Sukkot. The holiday commemorates the children of Israel's journey through the desert to the Promised Land after their exodus from Egypt. The Kohanim are descendants of the priestly family from the Second Temple, which was destroyed by the Romans in the first century of the Common Era.
All the Jews from all over the world get together here by the most holiest site, the Western Wall. Tens of thousands of Jews are here to pray to God on the holiday of Sukkot. Sukkot is one of the most festivities that we have together, all the Jews, and we have the blessing of the Kohanim, the priests. They come, hundreds, perhaps thousands of priests, bless us today, bless us for happiness, bless us for every blessing that one, all the Jews and everybody throughout the world should have.
يحاول الشباب الفلسطيني في كل مكان إيصال رسالتهم.
Everywhere and by all means, Palestinian youth are trying to express their concerns and convey their national plight to the world. Through rap songs and lyrics, Mohammed and Yassin, two youth from Burj al-Barajne refugee camp in Lebanon, are trying to express the pain of their nation due to the Israeli occupation's practices.
In a place located nearly 91 kilometers away from Palestine, Palestinians in the diaspora are expressing a feeling of longing for their homeland. While Palestinian elders are turning to coffee shops to listen to the songs of Fairouz, a revolutionized generation of Palestinian youth are expressing their pain in a different way.
أحلام محبوسة أيام معدودة بين أيام معدومة كل ضروبة عم بتناديك عشان ما تنسى وطنك خليك فلسطين بتشوفها بعيون الأولاد يلي زاد عاد ابعد لغاد بيوت على بعض مثل أخوة شعب فقير بس عنده النخوة في عبارة مثل السياسة بتقدم ورد لعدوك
بعيدا من السلاح ياسين ومحمد. Away from weapons, Yassin and Mohammed, two youth from Burj al-Barajina refugee camp in Beirut, founded a rap group called iVoice, which stands for Invincible Voice or Unbeatable Voice. The group's mission is to carry the voices of Palestinian youth and express their views on the Palestinian plight, the revolution, and the resistance, as well as politics.
والسياسة.
تركت المدرسة وكان عمري 13 سنة
I left school when I was 13 years old. I felt like I wanted to do something good for the Palestinian cause. I've seen the situation turn from bad to worse as Arabs are being pushed down.
I decided to start a rap production. I used to listen to songs by Tupac, Immortal Technique, and Dead Prez. I like the old school more than the new stuff. I see that many people are trying to rap, but I don't respect a rapper unless he has a plight he sings about, as the art of rapping was developed in the essence of a national plight.
اعطيني شوية هوا ازيد اكم كلمة علشان قلبي يرتوى للدوا اسعب بطلة سوى الفار نوى سطر او انفجر مالي مأوى نزف قوة ضعت بين ادم وحوا قلبي ضلت حصرة يوم اغتصاب البصرة نزف دم بشتيلة وصبرة مجزرة انا ودر ياسين نكبة 48 نكسة 67
في البداية كان الاعتماد على ما تيسر.
At the developmental phase, the iVoice rapping group had financial problems. Then an Australian cultural delegation came to the camp and launched a project dubbed Camp's Mobile Studio, which helped establish a studio for the band.
أعضاء الفرقة.
كلمات وموسيقى ياسين. The lyrics and the music played by Yassin and Mohammed, who are still in their late teens, reflect the political views of Palestinian youth and highlight their national aspirations of returning to Palestine under the slogan of unity for the entire Arab nation.
بالوحدة التي علها تجمع الشعب العربي.
Here and on these walls inside Burj al-Barajina refugee camp, Palestinian youth are expressing a revolution that has been suppressed inside them, a revolution against the occupation and its policy of forceful migration, a revolution against the internal division and the misery of displacement. In doing so, they are using a powerful language, the language of art. Lana Midwar, Palestine TV, Burj al-Barajina refugee camp, Beirut.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.